K98 Talk is expanding its lineup for 2015. This means we are expanding our advertising base. Whether you're a startup trying to push through to the next level, or an established business trying to supplement your advertising budget, web-based advertising is a solid investment. Thanks to Talk's newest partnership with TuneIn Radio and instant access to our sister station, K98 FM, we give you worldwide access at a reasonable cost. Interested parties should email us at sales@k98fm.com. You're listening to K98Talk.com, the way internet radio should be.
Well, hi, this is Denny C. with The Family Factor. We hope that this show will be a help to you as you search for answers with things, with problems and issues within your family's life.
Now, here's Denny C. on The Family Factor.
Well, good morning, everybody. This is Denny C. for The Family Factor. This is Friday. This is the 23rd of January already. And we hope that you've had a good week. We're at the end of this week. Tomorrow is Saturday and Sunday. And hopefully, if you work Monday through Friday, you got 2 days of rest. But other than that, we thank you for tuning in. You know, today we're going to be talking about something that has been a very interesting week for my wife's best friend. It was in the news, Channel 5, Channel 9, Channel 4 in Oklahoma City, about little Emery. Her real name is Emerson, who was diagnosed with strep. And at the same time, her mother thought she had the flu too. But when she took the child to the doctor, they said, well, she's got strep, so we're going to give her antibiotics, and that ought to be good enough. The flu will take care of itself, yada, yada, yada. Well, on Saturday evening, the mother got up around midnight and went in to check on her child, and her child was very, very hot and was kind of seizing. And so she checked her temperature, and her temperature was over 106 degrees. It was almost 107. So she called 911. The ambulance got there in 5 minutes. And the child, so the ambulance got there, and they tested, even though they asked the mother what was going on, the temperature of the child, yada, 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 they checked her temperature, and they told them, oh, she just has 102. She goes, no, she has 106 point something. Well, they sat there for another few minutes just filling out paperwork. And to make a long story short, they get to the ER in about 40 minutes. Well, when the ER gets there, when they get to the ER, the emergency room, instead of immediately taking this child in and doing the procedures necessary to save this child, such as putting ice on the child and putting oxygen on the child, they don't see the child for over 2 hours. Then they put her in ICU. Well, enough time has gone by with a high temperature and stuff. Her brain was gone. But the doctor wanted to make sure that it wasn't just due to the high temperature, that hopefully the brain, the doctor that was overseeing this child in ICU, want to make sure that that the brain was working before they turned off everything and pronounced the child dead. So Sunday and Monday and Tuesday, they kept testing and waiting and seeing and testing and waiting and seeing. The feet kind of moved. Of course, they got the temperature down. And then finally, Wednesday evening at 9 p.m., due to the brain being gone, they shut off the life support, and the child passed away. Well, the doctor who was overseeing this said he was going to write a lengthy report because his child, from the ambulance going forward, should have been iced over and should have been on oxygen. that the ER should have seen the child immediately, and it being that the child was not iced over, iced the child over, put the child on oxygen. And he's going to write a lengthy report because of the failure of these two previous departments acting in the best interest of the child versus assuming, oh, it's just another child who's sick. Now, the name of the child is Emerson. They call her Emmy. And her time of death was at 8:57 p.m. on Wednesday. And you can go to the Facebook if you want to know more about this. It's under Praying for Emmy. And, you know, there's several statements about her situation. Her mother has been, and her father has been talking about, keeping people up, like the funeral, where to send postcards, where to send flowers, the address of where the child's funeral is going to be. Now, the address, in case you would like to send a card or a flower, is at Rest Haven Funeral Home at 500 Southwest 104th Street in Oklahoma City, Oklahoma. Again, that is Rest Haven Funeral Home, 500 Southwest 104th Street, Oklahoma City, Oklahoma, 73139. And her services are going to be Monday at 10 a.m. at the Emus Baptist Church and Moore. And then the funeral home, well, then there in Rest Haven is where the child will be buried. And her mother, Leah, had already shouted out and thanked everybody for the prayers, the warm thoughts, the calls, the cards, the donations, and friendship that they've been surrounded by. And so, and if you want to order a t-shirt, where again, every dime of it goes to the help for this child's, you know, the cost the parents went through, then you can go to HTTPS. I tell you what, I will put this on the Family Factor website there. I'll put it on the Family Factor website at Family Factor at facebook.com/TheFamilyFactor. Let me do that real quick for you. So just go to facebook.com/TheFamilyFactor, and it is there that you will find that information. But I tell you what, it was something that was kind of unforeseeable. I mean, nobody thinks that they're going to lose their child, especially at the age of 5. Because when that happens, well, it's sad. Let's just put it that way. And I posted that there at the website. Well, we're going to be talking about when your child dies like that, and death in general, and what you go through, and how the hurt can happen. And again, our thoughts go out to the family, and especially the grandmothers, but definitely the mom and dad and the kid. She has two other sisters and a young brother. Over the loss of this little one. Well, so death is inevitable, yet the loss of a close friend or family member always showers us with a range of emotions. And one day, we might desperately try to avoid the pain, the anxiety, and feelings of helplessness we feel when a loved one dies. Other days, we feel like life has returned to normal, at least until we realize that our life has changed irrevocably. And so for several days to come, as well as holidays, the birthday of the young girl, the parents are going to have a hard time when grief hits them. I mean, think about it. Despite the gamut of emotions we feel, grieving for a loved one helps us cope and heal. The intense, heartbreaking anguish indicates that a deep connection has been severed. And without a doubt, grieving is painful, but it's also, unfortunately, necessary. So going forward doesn't mean forgetting about the loved one who died. Enjoying life again doesn't imply that the person is no longer missed. Piercing together your shattered emotions doesn't mean you somehow betrayed a friend or family member. It just simply means that your grief has run its course. And while no single pathway through grief exists, people do share common responses. Now, there's a book called The Five Stages of Grief, which represents the feelings of those who have faced death and tragedy. The first one is denial. This can't be happening to me. I don't want to believe it. So, haven't you been there where you wanted to deny the death of a loved one or a friend? The next one is anger. Why is this happening, and who's to blame? Or bargaining. Make this not happen, and in return I will. Do we not do that with the Lord? Depression. I'm too sad to do anything. And then finally, acceptance. I'm at peace with what has happened. So again, the five stages of grief is denial, anger, bargaining, depression, and acceptance. And although these are common responses to loss, there is no structure or timetable for the grieving process. And that said, understanding grief and its common symptoms are helpful when grieving. Recognizing the difference between trauma and depression is also beneficial. Besides understanding how stress can take its toll on us physically, emotionally, and spiritually, we need to understand the practical guidelines to ease the process. Number one, and this is important for all of you out there, especially for these parents, you need to take care of your bodies. That's the first thing. Number two, spend time with others and reach out to the church. That's you, your community of church, your church community. Yeah, you know, whoever it is that you're worshiping with. And there will come a time when someone close to us experiences a significant loss, and knowing how to respond to the grieving friend is a good first step in acting as a reliable companion. The death of a loved one is a shattering experience with far-reaching implications. And as difficult as a loss may be, it is possible to move forward with hope for the future. So that's just coping, but let's understand it, okay? So grief is a journey, often perilous and without clear direction. And the experience of grieving cannot be ordered or categorized, hurried or controlled, pushed aside, or ignored indefinitely. It is inevitably, as breathing, as changed, as love. It may be postponed, but it will not be denied. Grieving is going to happen. And when it comes to grieving the death of a loved one, there are no linear patterns, no normal reactions, no formulas to follow. I mean, the word grief is derived from the French word grieve, meaning a heavy burden. Indeed, the physical, emotional, and psychological and spiritual implications can be overwhelming. While grief is an unexpected response to a significant loss, the unfamiliar emotions that arise can lead to feelings of helplessness, fear, and isolation. Following a death, everyone works through the stressors differently. And some are instantly devastated. I mean, it just hits them. Others feel numb and disconnected. Some withdraw socially, while others reach out for support. And what's more, just when the initial shock begins to subside, a deeper sense of reality and despair sets in. Those who grieve may need to learn new skills, adopt different habits, and adjust to daily life without physical presence of the person who died. And although grieving is an individual experience, there are symptoms many people share after suffering personal loss. Number one, feels physically drained. Number two, can't sleep at night. Number three, forgetful and unable to think clearly. Number four, noticeable change in appetite. Number five, feel physical distress such as chest pains, heartaches of nausea. The next one, stays extremely busy to avoid thinking about his or her grief, or eats, drinks, watches television excessively, participates in harmful activities, senses or dreams about the deceased, becomes withdrawn, lonely, and apathetic. And the last one, frequent sighing and crying. Each person sets his or her own pace when grieving, and there will be ups, there will be downs, and moments of relief followed by moments of anguish. I mean, think about it. The first few days after someone dies are generally the most intense, marked by chaos, strong emotions, and a dream-like sensation. Over time, a host of emotions may emerge, from guilt to remorse to anger. Reactions vary from person to person, and it's not uncommon for grieving loved ones to ask questions like, "Why did this happen?" Or, "Where was God?" Or, "Why didn't the doctors find the cancer sooner?" Now, among those mourning a death, some find a pain diminish within weeks or months. They arrive at a place of acceptance, peace, and hope for the future. They reminisce about their deceased loved ones instead of feeling consumed by memories. And for others, the healing process persists and it's difficult to enjoy a reasonable quality of life. Everyday events and significant life markers are painful reminders of what could have been. If debilitating symptoms continue longer than 6 months, then you need professional help. You need to seek out a psychologist or a counselor or a therapist who can help you release the emotions that you may be storing up inside. The intensity of grief may relate to the following factors. And this being the family factor, I thought this is important to share with you. So number one, whether the death was sudden or expected. Number two, your feelings about the person who died. Number three, your personality, family background, coping style, and life of experience. Number four, your belief system and views on death. And number five, how those around you react and support you. So the intensity of grief may relate to those factors. That whether the death was sudden or expected. If it was sudden, not expected, it can really hit you. So the intensity of the grief may be very strong, such as in the loss of the little one. And or your feelings about that person who died, or your personality, your family background, and your coping style with life experiences. And then for those of us who believe in life hereafter, that can have a difference on how you deal with death and coping. But also, unfortunately, sometimes those around you and how they react and support you can have a problem or a positive, and you never know. So the grieving process can be long and isolating, yet it's crucial to accept support rather than grieve alone. I mean, talking about grief is an essential part of healing. I mean, reviving reassurance and feeling understood will help make the recovery process more complete and during one of life's most challenging times. Think about that. Well, we'll be right back after this commercials. Again, this is Denny C. for the Family Factor. We'll be returning in just a moment.
You can reach Denny C. of the Family Factor by tweeting him at Family Factors or the Family Factor at live.com.
Yeah. if you like your health care plan. You'll be able to keep your health care plan.
This is the most transparent administration in history. Not even a smidgen of corruption.
Fact is, we had four dead Americans. What difference at this point does it make?
If you've got a business, you didn't build that.
The feeling most people get when they hear a Barack Obama speech, I felt this thrill going up my leg. I don't have that too often.
Steady.
It's time to hear the truth about America's biggest challenges. Ricky Robinson, host of America Off the Rails, will tackle the important issues facing America today as he tries to keep America from coming off the track. Get ready to hear the truth every Monday through Friday starting at 7 p.m. Eastern, 6 Central, and on Saturdays at 12 p.m. Eastern and 11 Central here on K98Talk.com and the Spark Radio Network. In today's world of profit-driven news, no one just tells you how it is anymore until now. Opinion Nation, hosted by Bryce Robbins, gives you the facts, then waits for you, the listener, to provide the opinion. So tune in every Saturday morning at 11 a.m. Eastern, 10 Central, starting soon on K98Talk.com and the Spark Radio Network. You liked him on Facebook. You followed him on Twitter. The conservative curmudgeon radio show, a talk show host who's not afraid to say what's on his mind, a live in your ears kind of program, coming to a computer near you, starting in January every Thursday evening at 8 p.m. Eastern and 7 Central, brought to you by the Spark Radio Network and K98Talk.com.
This is Misty, owner of Wax It Studio in Edmond, Oklahoma, and I'm here to talk to you about a skincare product called Theramedics. Theramedics has a wonderful line of products from anti-aging to hyperpigmentations all the way to acne. In fact, everyone at some point in our life is affected by acne. Acne can cause a great deal of embarrassment and anxiety. And in order to prevent and help other people, I have tapped into this wonderful product called Theramedics. Visit my website at www.prettyskindeep.com. Again, that's www.prettyskindeep.com.
This week on God's Pure Word of Faith, Richard Harden will be discussing mercy, grace, and charity, God's love to us, and how we can receive the Spirit of Christ and become a new creature in Christ. Join him this Sunday morning at 7 a.m. Eastern, 6 Central, on K98 Talk and the Spark Radio Network. You're listening to The Family Factor with Denny C. on K98Talk.com. Join him bright and early every Monday, Wednesday, and Friday as he covers issues that relate to the family. Denny encourages your calls and emails with topics you would like for him to discuss. So set your alarm for 5 a.m., grab that first cup of coffee, and join The Family Factor to start your day. Now back to Denny C. and more of The Family Factor.
We're back, and we thank you for listening to the commercials. We have a lot to discuss, and of course, we appreciate all the guys and the shows that are out there, and we appreciate John for his work that he does with all the commercials. I mean, he's the guru of commercial making, I tell you what. But we're talking about grieving today and the hardships and how to deal with it and understanding it, and you know, we were talking about how the grieving process can be long and isolating, and yet it's crucial to accept support rather than grieve alone. So if you too have lost a loved one, then we pray that you will seek out those who can help you in dealing with your grief. Now, this show came about from the loss of little Emmy, the child who was 5 years old, who had both strep throat and the flu, having a high temperature of 107 And due to lack of the, from the medical staff, lack of, in the beginning of it all, lack of icing the child down, putting oxygen on the child to help her breathe, basically the child's brain was taken from the parents. The brain died, and that's what happened to little Emmy. So in talking about depression and the loss of a loved one, you know, there's grief, there's trauma, or is it depression? You know, after a loved one dies, those who grieve may find it difficult to function in everyday situations. Lingering emotional turmoil, a sense of shock, or social withdrawal are painful but natural reactions. Despite these expected symptoms, it is possible to become stuck in grief. And what if the loss prompts thoughts of self-harm or even suicide? Or how can trauma affect the healing process? I mean, think about that. How can it, right? Well, so, symptoms of grief and depression and trauma, unfortunately, can resemble one another. And in order to respond to these symptoms appropriately and move on with life, it's critical and crucial to understand the difference between grief, depression, and trauma. So when grief becomes what is called clinical depression, what do you do? And how do you catch it? How do you understand that that's what it is? You know, it's not unusual for those who grieve to feel despondent, empty, and anxious. Grief encompasses different emotions for different people, and it takes time to adjust to the loss and any accompanying charges and changes. Sometimes, though, the depressive state doesn't diminish over time and continues to disrupt everyday life. And this may be an indicator that you have what is called the depressive disorder. Now, according to the American Cancer Association, or Society, I should say, about 1 in 5 bereaved people will actually develop major depression. It is a difficult to predict whose grief will or won't turn into the depression following the death of a loved one. However, the following risk factors may increase the likelihood that you will become depressed based on the factors due to the following risk factors. Number one, is there a history of depression in your family? Is there? If there is, then you may end up having depression. What if you've never had little previous experience with death? You've really never dealt with death before. That can hit you. If you're alone and there's no support network, same thing. Intense depressive reactions early in the grieving process. And the final one is prior issues with alcohol or drug abuse. It is possible to grieve without being depressed. I mean, that said, there is a difference between the sadness of grief and the unrelenting numbness of depression. So let's look at these signs, and if you're going to write this down, it may help you. But, you know, there are signs that indicate whether a person is actually depressed or just grieving. Number one, the person will show symptoms of grief for 4 or more months with no sign of improvement. That's depression. Number two, prolonged or severe inability to function at home, work, or at school. It's like they're totally disconnected. That's depression. That's not just grieving. Or number three, they stay in bed all day. They do nothing. They're just totally cut off from the world. They're numb. They're depressed. Here's one that different times when I talk to different people, this came across their mind. They weren't going to do it, but then there are those who they really are thinking about doing it, and that is the thinking of suicide, or has a preoccupation with death. The another one is if they speak slowly or move slowly. And I've seen this happen where there are those who also, number five, they hallucinate, which may or may not relate to the deceased. And finally, feels worthless. If symptoms persist, and especially if suicidal thoughts occur, it is imperative to reach out to a family doctor, counselor, or perhaps your pastor. Those with depression will not simply just snap out of it. However, depression is highly treatable, and with competent care, a healthy life can be restored. So, what I want us to think about next is what happens when trauma blocks the grief. Losing a loved one in a sudden or unexpected way, such as a car accident, a heart attack, in the case of little Emmy, severe illness, murder or suicide, may result in a traumatic reaction that hinders the grieving process. And this sense of shock can also occur when the death is expected, as in the case of a long illness. But if a person is run down psychologically, suffers from anxiety or depression, or has endured previous traumatic experiences, it's more difficult to handle another setback. And as a result, additional grief symptoms can be unbearable. In order to cope, the traumatized individual may attempt to avoid grieving altogether. Now, I was looking up this stuff because I always like to, you know, kind of study and look into these things. I found that the National Center of Post-Traumatic Stress Disorder highlights broad types of symptoms that differentiate trauma from grief. They said, number one, re-experiencing symptoms, such as mentally replays the trauma while awake or asleep. They just over and over replay it in their minds. Number two, they want to avoid it. It's called avoidance symptoms. They avoid trauma-related activities, places, thoughts, or feelings. They're just going to avoid it. Number three, numbing symptoms. That is the loss of emotions, especially positive ones. And finally, number four, arousal symptoms. That's the difficulty in concentration and sleeping and a heightened sense of being on guard. So over time, if symptoms continue to influence life at work and home, then you need to be counseled. I would advise go get counseling. In addition to support groups, treatments that are both comforting and effective are available, and grieving the loss may be painful, but it is necessary to allow healing to start on, to occur, to begin. So, the next point I want to make is helping your loved ones with their grief. When someone we love is grieving with death of a family or friend or family member, it's a challenge to know what to do. We want to say the right thing, we want to show support, and we want to ultimately help them in the healing process, but yet all too often, we end up awkwardly offering advice, don't we? I've been there. Sputtering a spiritual rationalization or avoiding the situation altogether. This one woman by the name of Sarah, she remembers that early morning phone call, the immediate sense of dread, the sorrow in her husband's voice when he said, "Dad is gone." And she remembers hastily packing up her infant daughter and speeding to the fire station where Linus worked. She said, quote, "When I saw him, all I could do was hug him and cry. I had no idea what to say," unquote. Like Sarah, all of us try to be effective comforters, but may find ourselves coming short, not able to do it. Not that we don't want to, we just don't know what to say or what to do. And still, there are specific ways we can respond when those we love lose someone close to them. Number one, you need to acknowledge their loss. In an instant, the death of a loved one turns life upside down. Think about that. Emotions are peaked and responsibilities are overwhelming, and making it tough to know when to reach out and when to give space. Ann said, "I believe it's more helpful to acknowledge the loss. You can even simply say, 'I'm so sorry for your loss.'" Now, although the initial contact may feel nerve-wracking, taking a first step by promptly making a call, writing a letter, or paying a visit, it's what we need to do. Now, there are do's and don'ts when it comes to standing alongside someone in pain. And Kahara says, quote, "It's unhelpful, even callous, to say things like, 'This is God's will.'" And I totally agree with that personally. You don't, "This is God's will." No. They would want you to cry, or they are in a better place. Those type of things, you know, we can't presume to know the will of God, nor the emotional state of our loved one who is grieving. So to say things like that can actually cause greater pain. So instead, here's what I recommend you do. If you have a friend, a family member, a colleague you work with who has lost someone, number one, think about this with me, please. Number one, be there to listen. I mean, it's always tempting to give advice, but don't. True empathy, encouragement, and compassion will help those going through a difficult time. So just be there to listen. Number two, encourage professional help if necessary. If you feel your loved one isn't able to cope alone, gently recommend, and I said gently recommend that he or she seeks professional help. Providing a list of areas of grief counselors that may expedite the process. So encourage professional help if it's necessary. Number three, state specifically how you're there to help them, how you're able to help them. Offer to prepare a meal, provide a ride, help clean and sort through old items. Just be sensitive to your friend's feelings and proactive when it comes to meeting needs. Number four, remind your loved one to take time out to rest. They need to. So remind them you need to rest, as well as hold off any major life decisions. It is undoubtedly draining to adjust to a loss, and this impairs the ability to think clearly and make decisions. And finally, reach out when your friend most missed a loved one. Holidays, birthdays, anniversaries will often trigger the grief response, even many years later. I mean, those are good times to be extra supportive and loving. So when it comes to helping a loved one cope with loss, I think that what we've just talked about is very true. You know, after experiencing a loss, make sure that you help others the way you needed to be helped. As this one woman, Renee, said, I think the most valuable support we can possibly offer is to be there. Now notice how she says this, just be there. And be willing to not fill the space with our words. There are few things more powerful than knowing we are loved and supported through the valleys of life. And I think she's right on that. So just be there. When you show up, don't try to get them to talk. Let them talk when they feel like talking. Just be there. And when they want to talk, just be there to listen. And if they lose it, let them lose it. Let them get it out of their internal being because they're holding it bottled up. It may be anger. They may be so angry. And how in the world could this be allowed to happen that they would lose, in this case that we've been talking about, the death of their 5-year-old child? Let them let it out. Let them get it out of their body. Let them display any kind of emotion that they need to display. And if you're the one dealing with this, then you need to display any kind of emotion you need to display to get it out of your internal being. And then turn to God in prayer. Have a bite to eat. Take a nap or go to bed. We're not perfect. Life is not a life of perfection. When we are born, I hate to say it this way, we are born to die. We are born to literally die. Physically, that's speaking. And that being the case, it may come way, the death of your child or your spouse may come way in the beginning of a young life. Same thing if you're a child and you lose your parent. Well, learn from it. Let out the anger, the sadness, let it out, and move ahead. And if we're the ones there that are helping others cope with the death and grief of somebody, remember, listen to them when they talk. Don't butt in. Don't tell them what they need to do. Just be there to be supportive. It's that simple. Because many times, we just don't think about how it ought to be. Well, it's amazing that when these type of things happen, we sometimes give up. So don't. Don't give up. Press forward. We'll be right back after this last break, and we thank you for tuning into The Family Factor.
You can reach Denny C. of The Family Factor by tweeting him at Family Factors or The Family Factor at live.com. K98 Talk is expanding its lineup for 2015. This means we are expanding our advertising base. Whether you're a startup trying to push through to the next level or an established business trying to supplement your advertising budget, web-based advertising is a solid investment. Thanks to Talk's newest partnership with TuneIn Radio and instant access to our sister station, K98 FM, we give you worldwide access at a reasonable cost. Interested parties should email us at sales@k98fm.com. When shopping for yourself or that special someone, try a unique touch with White Apartment Studios, where they specialize in fine candles and custom gifts. Visit Stacy R's website at whiteapartment.etsy.com. That's whiteapartment.etsy.com, the world's most vibrant handmade marketplace. And tell her you heard it on K98Talk.com. Tune into The Family Factor with Denny C. every Monday, Wednesday, and Friday morning at 5 a.m. as he looks at all the challenges facing the family today. Denny will give you a refreshingly new look at tackling some of the biggest issues. So start your day off on the right foot with Denny C. and The Family Factor, right here on K98Talk.com.
This is Misty, owner of Wax It Studio in Edmond, Oklahoma, and I'm here to talk to you about a skincare product called Theramedics. Theramedics has a wonderful line of products from anti-aging to hyperpigmentations all the way to acne. In fact, everyone at some point in our lives is affected by acne. Acne can cause a great deal of embarrassment and anxiety. And in order to prevent and help other people, I have tapped into this wonderful product called Theramedics. Visit my website at www.prettyskindeep.com. Again, that's www.prettyskindeep.com.
If you like your health care plan, you'll be able to keep your health care plan. This is the most transparent administration in history. Not even a smidgen of corruption.
Fact is, we had 4 dead Americans. What difference at this point does it make?
If you've got a business, you didn't build that.
The feeling most people get when they hear a Barack Obama speech, Mike, I felt this thrill going up my leg. I don't have that too often.
Steady.
It's time to hear the truth about America's biggest challenges. Ricky Robinson, host of America Off the Rails, will tackle the important issues facing America today as he tries to keep America from coming off the track. Get ready to hear the truth every Monday through Friday starting at 7 p.m. Eastern, 6 Central, and on Saturdays at 12 p.m. Eastern and 11 Central here on K98Talk.com and the Spark Radio Network. You're listening to The Family Factor with Denny C. on K98Talk.com. Join him bright and early every Monday, Wednesday, and Friday as he covers issues that relate to the family. Denny encourages your calls and emails with topics you would like for him to discuss. So set your alarm for 5 a.m., grab that first cup of coffee, and join The Family Factor to start your day. Now back to Denny C. and more of The Family Factor.
tell you what, you know, we're coming into the close of the show, and we appreciate y'all listening today, and perhaps you are one of those that are dealing with grief. You know, it was a sad, sad experience. I was there Sunday with the family when Sunday afternoon, well, right after church, when the family was trying to deal with what can happen. It's sad, you know, and again, you know, if you want to in any way be a part of these things, then by all means, the family would appreciate it. And so you can always send flowers. Again, the funeral is not until Monday at 10 o'clock. So you could send flowers to the Rest Haven Funeral Home, 500 Southwest 104th Street, Oklahoma City, Oklahoma. That is Rest Haven Funeral Home, 500 Southwest 104th Street, Oklahoma City, Oklahoma, 73139. And send a letters to help the family through this unforeseeable loss of a five-year-old. And as I stated, I went ahead and put on the Family Factor at facebook.com/thefamilyfactor. I went ahead and put out the, if you wanted to order a shirt for that little child's needs, you know, for the cost that she went through, or if you wanted to go to the website, her website that talks about praying for Emmy, where all those information's found, you can just go to that website. I've got both of those on the Family Factor website. Well, we thank y'all for listening. It's things like this that help when we talk about them. So don't, if you've been grieving over somebody you've lost, don't let it build up any longer. Don't hold it within. Go ahead and try to work out those emotions. Get angry, yell, scream. I mean, don't do it at your job, don't do it in a public place, but do it privately or out in the country, at the top of a mountain. Let it out about how you feel about all of these things. For in so doing, it'll help you hopefully get a little better. Well, again, this is Denny C. We thank you all for tuning in. And we'll be back here Monday at 5 a.m. Central Time, 6 a.m. Eastern, with another section of The Family Factor. So we hope that you enjoyed the show. Again, have a great weekend. This is Denny C. with The Family Factor.
Thank you for tuning in to The Family Factor with Denny C. Be sure to join him every Monday, Wednesday, and Friday morning at 5 a.m. right here on K98talk.com and the Spark Radio Network.